Shalom, Islam, family, once again, it's the voice of your brother, Tazadaq, coming at you through the spirit of truth. For the record, I would like to reserve my rights according to the Creator that granted me my rights. This is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. I have no desire to offer legal advice. Should you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counselor, then please be advised. This is for informational, educational, and entertainment purposes only. You can take it how I give it, and I give it in the spirit of truth. So I ask that you receive it within the spirit of truth and not from an emotional standpoint. Shalom, Islam, family. This knowledge is actually intended to serve as a beacon light and examples of actually expressing the law and knowledge of self. Now, myself and the brother Baran is actually starting to go into a new level of awareness, should I say, because we've been teaching much about contract law, but it's time that we actually teach you some truth that's actually going to offend many. But the truth actually needs no apology. There's only one truth, and you shall know the truth. The truth may make you mad, but it would definitely make you free. So, many of you have been following these said-to-be free men, filing sovereignty papers, but it doesn't necessarily make you free. It is your own comprehension, brothers and sisters, and your mental status and the ability to actually orate the facts that actually set you free. Now, the divine lesson that are actually really at the root of our movement, should I say, because we actually have a movement. We're not individual. We're actually attempting to build unity amongst the people. And if you play the color code game, you're going to get lost. Again, I've said it time and before, this is a spiritual warfare. This is actually an ideological war. So I encourage you all, study, study, study. And then, as the brother Drew Ali said, if asked what to study next, I would say study yourselves. Study yourselves, people. It is actually essentially imperative that you study. And most of you don't. You get in the jams and then you come to us once you're in the jam. Now, what I'm going to say is going to offend many. But the truth needs no apology. We've actually had guests on our radio show, and people may have actually stated or cited certain information that we was actually not in agreement with. But everyone is actually entitled to their view. And once they actually express their view, if we are not in agreement with that particular view, we actually like to bring the facts to actually denounce and demolish the fiction that came from an individual view or a mass point of view standpoint that was not necessarily the truth. Now, what if I told you that the United States Constitution actually comes from ancient Moorish law? What if I told you that we are the founders of this government in America? And what if I told you that Europeans actually adopted our law? What if I told you that you are not the Negroes, you so-called people that's labeling yourself as blacks, Jamaicans, Trinidadians, Haitians, so on and so forth? What if I told you that you're not the Negroes? What if I told you that your so-called Puerto Ricans are not Hispanics? What if I told you that the Europeans are the real colored man? Now, what I'm going to tell you is that everything, the vast majority of what you have learned, has been lies. I know you got your BAs, your MS, your PhDs, and your BS, and that's about the size of a lot of it. It's a bunch of BS. I'm not here to actually denounce anyone's education, nor am I suggesting that a sound education is wrong, but the people are not being properly educated. You do not know who you are. Now again, what if I told you that the Europeans was the real colored man and your birthright was actually stolen? I mean, think about it. Blind hair, green eyes, blue eyes, gray eyes, brown hair. These are futures of what is referred to as Europeans, or as many of you Jakes refer to as Edomites. They are the real colored people. Now, it's time that the truth come forth. We had an individual on our show. He went by the screen name of Thunder7. He said some things that we was definitely not in compliance with. So it's time that we bring forth the truth to replace the lies. This actually has nothing to do with the color spectrum, because that's actually a code game. But this has something to do with actually telling you the truth that's actually been hidden for ages. And we're going to bring you that truth. Creditors, debtors, contracts, and commerce. Now you can like it, understand it, believe it or not. We're going to give you the truth. And we dare or challenge any of you to put out your video disputing. Well, not disputing, because we don't argue or disproving the truth. And you cannot disprove the truth, because there's only one truth. Now, what if I told you that those that work for Rome has actually cast spells on the so-called whites and so-called blacks, and the truth is the opposite of the vast majority of what you've been taught? Now, did you know that the word church was actually German? It's a German word, which actually means circle, and religion is actually a study of the stars. Now, these enchanters, people, they've deceived you. They've deceived you. Now, you actually need to be reattached to the truth. And when I say re, means to go back. Because reconstruction history has the vast majority of the people on the earth today deceived. You're actually slaves to a mental death and power. The color game, that's been used on you. Game is actually a code game. Were you not taught that black and white is actually not even in the color spectrum in grammar school? Were you not taught that? So then why are you referring to yourselves as blacks? Why are you referring to yourselves as whites if it's actually not even part of the color spectrum? Why do you do such things? It's rhetorical. You don't have to answer it. Now, what if I told you that color means a fraud or that which is actually fake and extinguished from that which is real? Now, many of these Masons, these high degree Masons, they know the truth. Mason, I am my mother's son. That's what it actually really means. I mean, that's what Masonry really means. And Masonry is essentially Islam. And many of you so-called black men, you go out and you study this, and you think you have some sort of secret. The secret is that you're studying yourselves. So this country is actually operating under U.S. democracy. And it actually is supposed to be a republic, but you people do not challenge it. Now, the bill in particular actually gives right under the republic. Now, what they use to control you, brothers and sisters, is a process which is actually birthright theft. And you do not know that sovereignty is actually in your birthright. Now, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, when he was governor of New York, and if you doubt it, listen, don't believe anything that we tell you. Go and do the research. When he was governor of New York, and before he actually was inaugurated into office as president, when he was, you know, he's a 33rd degree Mason. Did you know that in March 9th, 1933, that Congress put out Resolution 75 would actually enable Moors to claim their names and the right to use of them? Why haven't you done it? Then, in April 5th, 1733, they started to take that birthright away. And also, June 5th, 1933. Those is actually the 5 dates. Now, the people that came here are not Americans. The people that settled here are not Americans. Now, if this upset many, oh well, so be it. But you're not indigenous to this land. You're not Americans. This land was ours prior to you coming here, and this land is still ours. Who would charge this government for one of the greatest thefts in the annals of history? Coming and depriving a people of their land and their mental capacity to think that they don't even belong here. The vast majority of you think that you all came here in slave ships. That's a lie. And the truth's going to have to be told. And someone needs to be brave enough, bold enough, and courageous enough to stand up and tell that truth. And we here at Creditors, Debtors, Contracts, and Commerce has that spirit to stand up and tell the truth. Now, the people that came here, brothers and sisters, they're not Americans. They're not Americans. We are the Americans. Amexums is ours. Amexum is ours. They settled on our land. We are not United States citizens. We're not United States citizens. We never have been. Now, you have a right to contract. So you declare yourself as that. Many of you was compelled to take yourself out of your sovereign capacity and become wards of the state upon which you live. Now, brothers and sisters, you must know law and government. I keep insisting that you study and study hard. The free man movement, that's not of us. That's not us. Gold has nothing to do with our sovereign status. That's birthright, brothers and sisters. Your nationality is your sovereignty. Now let's talk jurisdiction for a minute. Are you with me thus far? Let's talk jurisdiction for a minute. Now the Congress, under the war power, when Roosevelt was actually getting busy, assigned the jurisdiction and the booty and prize to the district court only. Now, you need to listen to me, brothers and sisters, because many of you go into court and you give them jurisdiction over you without even actually understanding what's going on. And don't tell me that you don't, because I see it all of the time. Then you come to us And you really don't understand the process of what you're undergoing or what you're doing. So, brothers and sisters, again, when Roosevelt was doing his thing, was getting down, was getting busy, Congress actually assigned the jurisdiction, the booty and prize to the district court only. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, this means that any court inferior to the district court, which is actually an Article 3 court, has no jurisdiction. Did you hear me? Do you follow me? Any court that's inferior to a district court has no jurisdiction unless you consent, unless you grant it, unless you give it to them unknowingly. Now, brothers and sisters, Moors, when you go to court, and when I say Moors, I mean you so-called Negroes, blacks, and colors. That's referring to yourself as these brands or these colors, making yourselves property. When you go to court and you contract, or when you go to court, what you should do is actually construct your affidavit of facts. Pretty much in court, we want to deal specifically on affidavits. And when you actually inform the judge that you have, that, you know, the judge don't have jurisdiction, it's not only because you are a Moor, but because this court is an inferior court, and the inferior court does not have jurisdiction on any level under their own process. Because Congress actually assigned jurisdiction to the district court only, and these inferior courts has no jurisdiction. That's what you actually need to start going in for an educational purpose in these courts presenting. Show subject matter jurisdiction. This is not a district court. You don't have jurisdiction over me. I would like the court to show subject matter jurisdiction. Now, any court inferior to the district court does not have jurisdiction. This is actually required by law if you know law. And whenever they alter a law, they must present a remedy. Now, I'm giving you the remedy, brothers and sisters. Subject matter jurisdiction. Islam. Now, when they, excuse me, when they brought maritime admiralty law on the land, the jurisdiction was actually assigned to the district court, a level 3 court. Do you follow me? So, why are you allowing them to actually adjudicate you from the start? And brothers and sisters, don't do this on an individual level. We must unite. We must unite. We must form a body. I and Brother Baran are not your leaders. Creditors, debtors, contracts, and commerce is not your leaders. We're just facilitators. The class, the message is instructed by the Most High. So join us in empowering this movement. Individually, we are weak, but as a body, we are strong. If my fists, my fingers are separated like this, I don't have a lot of strength in them if I hit you. But if I bring them together, the force of this hand becomes stronger. And if I clench it together in a tight fist, it becomes even stronger on the point of impact. United, we're strong. Therein is power. Our unity is our nationality, or we're very weak. Now, we're not advocating hate. We are advocating build something for our people. It's time to grow our own crops, build our own schools. Stop going to the de facto, like Lazarus, begging for the crumbs that fall from the table. We want to raise you like justice did Lazarus, or many of you may refer to him as Jesus. But you don't want to hear the message. You don't want to study. You want some silver bullet to kill off these vampires, and they are vampires. I suggest that you define what a vampire really is. They are vampires. You want a silver bullet to kill off these vampires, but you don't want to work to construct it. So this Constitution and the laws of the United States, which shall actually be made, let's look at Article 6. It's time that we have a look at Article 6 right now. It's essential, it's of essential importance that we stop and we read Article 6 of the United States Constitution of North America of 1791. So if you have a constitution, you can follow along. Now, it doesn't require any interpretations. It's crystal clear and to the point. I won't need to interpret anything. So Article 6 of the Constitution, 1791, let's look at it. This Constitution and the laws of the United States, which shall be made pursuant thereof, and all treaties made, or which shall be made under the authority of the United States, shall be supreme law of the land. Did you get that? The supreme law of the land. And judges in every state shall be bound thereby. That's why they all take their oath. Anything in the Constitution or laws or any state to the contrary, notwithstanding, the senators and representatives before mentioned and the members of several state legislators and all executive and judicial officers, both of the United States and of the several states, shall be bound by an oath of affirmation, all of them take an oath, to support this Constitution, but no religious test shall ever be required as a qualification to any officer of public trust under the United States. Now, that's crystal clear. So all contracts, in all debts or whatever that was actually previously owed, old debts, contracted and engagements entered into before the adoption of this Constitution shall be made in pursuit thereof and old treaties. And guess what, brothers and sisters? They signed the treaty of peace with us. This is why I encourage many of you Moors to go back and look at that treaty of peace so you could understand what we're talking about. Now, who is an American? Who's an American? Let's look at it. Let's use their literature to see what an American is. And let's look at Webster's English Language 1936, unabridged 26th century dictionary. American. It's a noun. It's an aboriginal or one of the various copper-colored. That's me, copper-colored. Copper-colored natives found on the American continent by Europeans. So if the Americans was found on the American continent by Europeans, Europeans can't be Americans. Now this is truth. And if it hurts you, if it cuts, and if it's a cold cut, that may be good. Digest it and eat it well. Because the truth will make you free. You may get a little mad if you're an emotional person, but it will make you free. So Americans was found on the American continent by Europeans, meaning that the Europeans could not be an American. And if you're not an American, if you're not indigenous to this land, can you be sovereign? That's rhetorical. You don't have to answer it. So the original application of the name.
It's 7 o'clock.
And this is according to Webster's, again, Webster's dictionary. We didn't write this. I'm just quoting what the book says. Webster's 1828 American Dictionary. Do you follow me? So Al-Moroccan, American, Moors, Al-Moroccan, American, the original people. Now note the correlation of the word Al-Moroccan, brothers and sisters, and American. So Americans, or Al-Moroccan, or Moors, were the first people actually formed in the flesh, and are the original and indigenous people of America. America. And America, or America, is actually the heartland of many of you, and you don't know that because you've been taught that all of you came here in the holds of slave ships. And that's a lie. That's a lie, brothers and sisters. So the American or the Amerikan people, as defined in Webster's dictionary, are any one of the various copper-colored natives found on the continent by Europeans, meaning that Europeans cannot be Americans. So if you want to be sovereign, can you be if you're not indigenous to the land? Now, this is the truth. Now, the national identity, Moors, comes from Almoraco, which is actually contemporary called America. America. And the Americans, the Almoracan, copper-colored skin, contains Turanesians, which is a copper-containing enzyme, like in my skin. Now, I want to clear something else up also. Now, many of you has been falsely taught, again, by Europeans, or as Jake say, Edomites. Now, this is not to attack anyone. It's the truth. And if you don't like the truth, then hey, change this channel or get on your own soapbox and you put something out that you claim or you may think can actually dismember this truth, but you can't do it because the truth is actually consolidated as the truth and it would always stand as the truth. But you're entitled to do so. You can stand on your own soapbox if you don't like what's being said here on this channel. But this channel is about bringing the truth despite whose feelings it may hurt. I'm going to tell the truth, and the truth will make you mad, but make you free. Now, the true light bringer. The true light bringer. Now, I want to talk to you about a little bit about Lucifer, because many of you have been falsely taught that Lucifer is the devil, and that's a damn lie. Now, Masons, they know the secret that Lucifer is not the devil. It's Europeans that indoctrinated this lie again that Lucifer is the devil. Lucifer has nothing to do with the devil. Lucifer was actually a king of Babylon. When you go and read the book of Isaiah, the 14th chapter, verse 4 tells us that it was the king of Babylon. Lucifer was not the devil. You do err not knowing the scriptures, nor the power of the Heavenly Father. Now, the true light bringer, now notice, I want you to notice, brothers and sisters, in the hand of the Statue of Liberty is a torch symbolizing light. Now, the Statue of Liberty is actually symbolic to the copper-colored Amerikan woman and Venus, the light bearer, or the light bringer. Now, unfortunately, many have actually codified Venus, the light bearer, as Lucifer. And they say Lucifer is a devil. That's a damn lie. And Lucifer, and had codified Lucifer as something negative, as a negative entity, as Satan, or has codified Lucifer in a negative manner. Now, Lucifer was, you know, if we're referring to the one in the king of Babylon, he was a very wicked man. He was a very wicked man. But in doing so, they have actually buried the truth about the womb man who actually rises as the morning star and the evening star. Now, Lucifer, in its original translation into English, literally means light bringer or light bearer. That's all that means. Now, let's look at it. Lucifer. Let's look at the etymology of it. Lucifer is Latin. Lucifer means light bringing. Lux. Luscious, light, to bear. Now, the planet Venus, when it is the morning star, is called brightness. Now, I said that Lucifer was the king of Babylon. So let's prove all things. Let's prove, my only point of reading this is to prove that Lucifer has nothing to do with the damn devil you've been lied to again. So Lucifer was the king of Babylon, Isaiah the 14th chapter. Lucifer was Lucifer was not the devil. Lucifer had nothing to do with the devil. He may have had that spirit of Satan, but he has nothing to do with the devil. It's just another European lie. And not all Europeans indoctrinate this. It's the 10% that actually controls the 85%. So 5% of us has been actually awakened to the truth, and we came forth with the truth. Tazadaq, are you a 5%er? No, but I'm God. Psalms 82, verse 6. So I come with the truth. Do you follow me? So, and the truth, again, needs no apology. Book of Isaiah 14, chapter verse 4. That thou shalt take up the proverb against the king of Babylon and say, how hath thou oppressors cease, the golden city cease? And we jump down to the 12th verse, we will see that this king of Babylon was Lucifer. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground? Now, what does that mean? The heaven that they're talking about is rulership. This heaven is rulership. It's not some place in the sky. He didn't fall from the sky. Heaven is rulership. Heaven is rulership. And it tells you Idumean is going to be kicked out of heaven. But I don't want to go into that. I don't want to get off the subject. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nation? He weakened the nation before his philosophies and lies. For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into the heavens. I will exalt my throne above the stars. Now he got satellites and out of space up above the stars, looking down at anyone, invading everybody's privacy. I would exalt my throne above the stars of Yah. I would sit also upon the mount of congregation. The mount of congregation that they're talking about is sitting on is Yahshua'Allah in the size of the north. In the size of the north is referring to right here, North America, that you call America, a Mexican, and they came here and they rule us. The same spirit fulfilling the scriptures again. Fulfilling the scriptures again. Now, brothers and sisters, Moors are the aboriginal and indigenous people of America, Amerako, which includes North, South, and Central America and the adjoining islands. Now, in this era of information that brings these moments of knowing the ledge, of knowing knowledge, or the ledger, that which is written, it is incumbent upon the aboriginals to actually know their heritage. You've got to know your heritage and history of civilization. Now, particularly what happened here in Amerako, America. Now, you so-called African-Americans, those of you that say, well, Tazadaq, the stuff you're talking is actually crazy. I'm African-American. I'm a Muslim. So on and so forth. Listen, man. African-American actually indicates the name of two continents. I want you to think for a minute. African-American. That actually indicates the name of two continents. Africa and America. Those of you who are the aboriginal and indigenous people, the Moors, which means was actually the first navigators. And when I say navigators, I mean, you know, an adjective, and are clearly, when you trace it back, the first people, and that's a noun. Now, why do I say we was the first navigators? Because we was. We were first to navigate on the waters of the earth after we actually navigated in the womb. After we actually navigated in the womb of the womb, man. After we navigated in the womb of the womb, man, of the mother earth. And being detached from her navel, from which they got the expression naval ships, we was detached or cut from her navel of the womb, man, at the navigating in her waters, becoming navigating L upon the earth's plane. 139,685,000 square miles of it. So, brothers, how can you disrespect the womb man when you have a navel? Can anyone escape this process? I want you to think about that. Many of you jakes, you go out and you disrespect the womb man, but you have a navel, showing that you was once attached to her. Now, those people that coin Negroes, blacks, and coloreds, African-Americans, Afro-Americans, and so on and so forth. Excuse me. They deceive you. Now, all points, north, south, and central, and the adjoining islands, that's us. You are, in fact, the descendants, the mothers of the mothers and the fathers of this continent known as America. You are the descendants, brothers and sisters. You are indigenous to this land, but you suffer from miseducation and aphasia and lies. So they essentially suffer from indoctrination that's actually set forth into the public school system, or should I say the public food system, these so-called institutions of higher learning, and deaf, dumb, and blind parents that indoctrinated this madness into your thought pattern, into your thought process. Now the education system has actually failed us. And it's continuously dumbing down the people. Now, proof of this could actually be found in these state tests. That sadly enough, the people have actually been torn away from their natural attachment to the earth and from what the earth actually provides, even to those who actually taken from it, actually, you don't want to live off of the earth anymore, brothers and sisters. You don't want to live off of the earth anymore. You're eating a lot of genetically engineered foods. You don't want to grow your own crops and so on and so forth anymore. You're consuming a lot of madness. So you're dying early. 75% of Americans are overweight. You're fat. Now, I hate to talk to you this way. If it offends you, unless you have a thyroid problem, then maybe you should go on a diet. But I'm going to tell you the truth. And if it offends you, then oh well, so be it. But you're killing your souls early. Well, I got to die something, Tazadaq. Yeah, but you don't have to rush it. Brothers and sisters, we must return. We must return to the earth that provides for us all. We must return, and we must return to the Heavenly Father. So we must start to grow our own crops. When I say return to the earth, I don't mean to go and worship the earth. Book of Jeremiah 2, verse 4. Hear ye the word of the Lord, O house of Jacob, and all of the families of the house of Yahshua'Allah. Thus saith the Lord, what iniquity have your fathers found in me, that they are gone far from me and have walked after vanities and become vain? Many of you brothers and sisters have become vain. You've turned your backs on your creator. You follow all of these different philosophies. Democratic, Republican, so on and so forth. Baptist, Jehovah Witness, Seventh-day Adventist. You follow all of these different philosophies. And they're not teaching you the truth. This is not to insult anyone's religion, but you need to delve deeper into this to get the truth. We don't grow our own food for ourselves, brothers and sisters. You've learned to hate the foreign. and you will actually continually to be poisoned at a younger age, at a young age, and continue to rush death as long as you allow someone else to grow food for you. And I want you to couple this with drugs, guns, excessive sex, and alcohol, and all these other reference points, which actually negatively affects our youth. Now, I mean, when you consider this, it sounds like a genocide. And brothers and sisters, it's taken quite some time to pull the people away from what naturally was supposed to be. And reason being is because people are fairly resilient. And the history is actually long-reaching and illustrious. Now, many may not be ready to accept the full validity of the fact that those who actually have coined these terms, Negroes, Black, Colored, African-American, Afro-American, and so on and so forth, have actually done so immediately to actually detach them from the land, this land right here, Amexum, or America, and absolutely places them in enslavement. You're a slave. You're a Black slave. You're a colored slave. Consider yourself a colored boy. You're a slave. Consider yourself an African American. You're a damn slave. I don't care how much education you got. You've been miseducated and you're a slave. You're a slave. What's your nationality? Oh, I'm an African American. Right? Stop right there. I know that you're a slave. You're a slave. You're a Black slave. You consider yourself a Black man. You're a slave. We got an African movement. You're a slave, boy. If this offends you right now, stop. Turn the channel. Don't flag the video. Let's turn the channel. You don't even belong here because it's going to take more than this to wake you up. Oh, the truth hurts. The truth cuts. So, brothers and sisters, you've actually been detached from reality. You've been detached from the land, and this actually places you in enslavement. Now, although it's actually bureaucratic on paper and it's a mental death, it's still a form of slavery, and it might be the worst form. Now, it is these colors, brothers and sisters, Black, white, and these brand names that was coined, which actually on the surface indicate that you are actually not tied to nationality. Who are you? Who are you? What is your nationality? This is the operative, or should I say this operative, brothers and sisters, is the purpose and the intent. As there is no such land as Negro land. There is no such land as Black York. There is no such land as Colorado. Colorado. So how you carrying these names that does not link you to a land? And if you're not linked to a land, how can you have a nationality? Those names and the coining of these names actually indicates the purpose and the intent to actually disconnect the people from the land of Mexico, Amoraco, America. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? Now, did you know that the term African-American indicates two continents? Within those two continents as we know them today, there's actually 52 nations within one of them, the one that's known as America. There's 52 different nations there. Huh? But we seem to get closer to the point, brothers and sisters, but we are not yet competent to claim our own inheritance as the aboriginal and indigenous people of the land. This is why they call us minorities. You thought it has something to do with numbers. Minority has nothing to do with numbers, brothers and sisters. Minority has nothing to do with numbers. It certainly has nothing to do with numbers. on the planet, because the melanated people, you see this is melon, the melanated people were dominant in numbers all over the world. Now the truth has to be told. We are called minorities because we are minors in mind. You have the capacity of children and at your mindset. You're incompetent wards of these states. We are incompetent to handle our own affairs, so they appoint a representative to represent what has never been presented in the first place. A representation is not real. A representation means someone else is representing what should be there. So why do we walk without knowledge of ourselves, which is actually dangerous to ourselves, dangerous to others, and dangerous to society and the world in general? It's rhetorical. You don't have to answer it. Many of you probably can't. Many of you probably can't. So the Aboriginal and Indigenous people need to also become familiar with the rights of the Indigenous people. An international proclamation wherein the international community is in support of that. And actually affirms the truth regarding the Aboriginal and Indigenous people of the families of nations. Do you follow me? You need to become familiar with the Declaration of Human Rights. How many of you are familiar with that? You need to become familiar with the Declaration of the Human Rights of Indigenous people. Now, you need to become familiar with the Declaration of the Rights of the Child. Now, the Declarations of the Rights of the Child were actually intended and were supposed to be disseminated into public schools and the public institutions as they actually indicated in their preambles. Why wasn't it done? They did not disseminate that into the public school system and the public institutions. Why? Obama assisted to the end and recently signed the Declaration of the Indigenous People, something that Bush and Clinton nor any prior administrators ever done. So these proclamations are further proof and brings to the forefront, brothers and sisters, the so-called Indians are not the Indigenous people. We're the Indigenous people. We're the Indigenous people, brothers and sisters. Now, how many of you could digest that? America is not India, brothers and sisters. America is not India. And at that time, supposedly, Christopher Columbus supposedly discovered America. That's such a damn joke. His discovery was actually on the shores of Haiti in America. Did you know that? And America was already a heavily populated continent at that particular time. It was a juris society with an established government. America is ours, brothers and sisters. America is ours, and it's time that you wake up and realize that. That's the secret. That's the secret. Now, this evidence is actually in the congressional records that America is the Moroccan Empire. The World Trade Center that was actually in New York is actually coined in New York. Should I say, is actually coined the Empire State, and the World Trade Center building was actually a memorial to this truth. Study, 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 brothers and sisters. Know who you are. Know your nationality. It is a must. It is a must, brothers and sisters. Well, let me talk a little more about history. Now, did you know that there are periods of history or historical truths and times that those who coined those brand names for those now that refer to themselves as Negroes, Blacks, and Colored today were slaves to the Moors. Sure, many of you knew that. Now, Europeans were in slavery at the hands of Jakes, or Moors, as well. And they enslave each other. Europeans also enslave each other. So let's not play the color game. This is not about the color game. Now, brothers and sisters, maybe this will actually assist in taking off the victim face, because a lot of you like to play the victim. Oh, we was enslaved and slavery done this to us. Yeah, it's true. But you also enslaved them. I don't hear a lot of Europeans complaining about, oh yeah, you enslaved us and so on and so forth. Listen, man. Get off of your lazy behinds and start to study. Start to build. So brothers and sisters, when you cut the pie, know that you had so-called whites as slaves also. Now this truth also must be told, because the unadulterated truth has not been told. And it must be told until the people themselves tell their own heritage and history. Truth needs no apology. And it does not change or pass away. The truth doesn't change or pass away. You could try and hide it, try to conceal it, but it's going to resurface just like we're doing now. The truth is going to come, and it's going to make a lot of people mad, and it makes people get envious and want to destroy the tellers of the truth. It is a fact, brothers and sisters, those who coin the so-called Negroes, Coloreds, and Blacks are now probably angered with the information that I'm presenting to you. So these names was actually coined, Negro, Blacks, and Colored, as brand names, and was actually devised and put upon Moors of North America for actually the purpose of stealing our birthrights. The purpose was to steal our birthrights from them, and it's been done. Now, more importantly, that this enslavement created a mental slavery until present day. Most of you are slaves. You don't know who you are. You've been coined as Negroes, Blacks, and Colored, and that's what slavery really is, because you declare yourself as a United States citizen. So now you're subject to all of the codes, regulations, ordinance, and so on under the United States, which is a federal corporation. So, brothers and sisters, Aboriginal means the first originals, and those who are the Aboriginals possess the divine right. So brothers and sisters, welcome to the truth, because I don't know what to do besides tell the truth. Now many of you refer to Allah as God. Many of you, Jake, say Allahim, the powers. So let me develop into that subject. Let us look again at the issues of law. Now, again, I would like to first explain the meaning of the word minority. When used other than common parlance, the word means a social political condition, and it's actually not dealing with numbers. Now, under common law, which is the law of the sovereign, there's only three ways to break the law. Under the common law, harm another living soul, use fraud or mischief in a contract, or damage someone's property. Now, this is according to the rule judge, which is the grand architect of the universe, the YHWH, the creator, Yahweh, or as you Muslims say, Yahweh subhanahu wa ta'ala, or whatever name you may call upon him on. no one can say that any name is wrong, because the Father tells us that he will give us a true language in the end. Now, the Sixth Amendment of the Constitution of the Federal Republic reserves we the people a right to trial by jury. It doesn't give us anything. The Constitution does not give you rights. Rights are inherent. Now, I did not say person. Persons have no rights. They have privileges. A person is a corporation or a fiction and exists on paper. We the people have rights not given to us by the Constitution, but the Constitution actually reserves rights that are inherent. We are born with such rights, and a right and a privilege is not one and the same. A right, again, is inherent. I'm born with the right to be able to live my life. Even if you kill me, I still have that right to live. You cannot deprive me of that right. Now, you could kill me, but I still possess that right to live. Do you follow me? Now, a privilege is something that's granted to someone by another person of higher authority. Say, a civil, what they entitle civil rights, is really a privilege that was granted to you by someone of higher authority. The only reason that you so-called blacks, those of you that refer to yourself as blacks, Negroes, and colored, can still vote since your property, is because the legislators vote to be able to let you vote from 2007. If a legislator did not vote to allow you to continue voting in 2007, you would not have been able to vote in 2008. Do you understand? Now, you also have rights that are inherited that cannot be deprived from you, but you have a right to contract. And if you want to contract to be a corporation, you are entitled to do so. And since ignorance of the law is no excuse, most of you have already done so. Now, juries is actually found in common law jurisdiction. A trial without a jury is actually known as a bench trial, in which the magistrate or the judge, both the questions of fact and questions of law, are actually decided by the magistrate or the judge. Now, please note that this is not a court of record. In a true court of record, you are sovereign, and there is no judge. There is a jury of your peers, and a peer is not a citizen. If you're a sovereign, how can your peer be a citizen? A peer is not a citizen. A peer is another sovereign if you are operating in your sovereign capacity, not just John Doe off of the street. Now, I would encourage you to look at Black Laws, 4th edition, for proof on that, to find a word court of record in Black Laws, 4th edition. Don't go to the 5th edition, because they've actually taken away a couple of the requirements for what a court of record is. Now, one might ask the question, what is common law? Or what is law? Law governs all. All law. So, all equals the law. So, many of you say Allah, or Allah, A-L-L-A-H, is God. But Allah is not God in this society. What do you mean, Tazadaq? Because God in this society is governmental ordinance department. So who could use law, brothers and sisters? Only the people that's actually operating in a sovereign capacity could actually use law. And the vast majority of the people today live under mob rule, known as democracy, and are slaves to the de facto, which claim to be government. But it's not a true government. De facto existing in fact, but not officially recognized. So the judge, the magistrate, the attorneys, the lawyers, the esquires, and so on and so forth claim to really use law. But they use words of art to persuade you that when you walk into a public courtroom, that law is on the table. But what they're really using is color of law and public policy. Do you follow me? A proclamation is not law, brothers and sisters. A proclamation is that which is proclaimed by public announcement or by elected officials, and it is not law. A sovereign is equated to authority, and authority is equated to sovereign. So a sovereign is one who has the supreme power or authority. Thus, again, sovereign is authority, and authority is sovereign. Law could actually only be used by people in their sovereign capacity. And the vast majority of the people in the world today are slaves. If you are a citizen of the United States, their codes, their statutes, their regulations, their ordinances, their resolutions apply to you. Brothers and sisters, most of us were reduced from our sovereign capacity and compelled to join what is known as nation states. Now, the people that established this and the states, these states, they actually impose these codes, statutes, acts, ordinances, rules, and regulations and call them law, but they are not law. They're public policy. The people that enforce these are in a ward status, and they are wards of the state. They cannot issue law. They cannot issue law. These people are members of a corporation. And you register by way of your birth certificate, by way of your 1040 form, by way of your driver's license, and so on and so forth, because you have a right to contract. And remember, anything that you register, you actually give up the true title to. And the only true title is the MSO, the Manufacturer Statement of Origin. So as long as you have contracts with these states, then you have that you have actually not revoked, then you belong to the state. And that's what slavery really is. The 14th Amendment actually reduced many people from their sovereign capacity to citizens and forced them to join these nation states. If you are a member of a corporate ward state that calls itself the United States of America, which is a corporation, then you are a citizen. A citizen is not a sovereign, brothers and sisters. A citizen is not a sovereign. A resident is not a sovereign. A resident, if you say that you are a resident, essentially what you're saying is that you do not belong here, that you came here to actually do commerce. And when you're finished conducting that commerce, then you have to leave. So if you're saying that you are a resident of the state of New York, what you're really suggesting to them is that you're from outside of the state of New York and you're here for a commercial purpose, and they are actually entitled to regulate you because the Constitution grants Congress the power to regulate interstate commerce. Therefore, they are entitled to regulate you. Brothers and sisters, we, the people, granted such authority to them by way of the Constitution. Now, many so-called freemen have been taught that blacks were, you know, there was a guy on our radio station referring to himself as Thunder 7. He was saying that blacks, you know, essentially, he was basically saying blacks could not be in a sovereign status, and that we could apply for naturalization and so on and so forth. That's a lie. That's for those that don't really know the truth. Now, this Constitution was actually adapted from our Constitution. This government was adopted from the Moorish government. Read the letter from George Washington that he wrote in New York to Muhammad Ibn Abdullah, and you shall know the truth. So, nevertheless, brothers and sisters, we are indigenous to this land. So we were sovereigns when Europeans came here. Now, you could like it, understand it, believe it or not. We was operating in a sovereign capacity. But we was actually overthrown. And many of you have came here. Many of you Europeans has actually come here and declared yourselves as an American, thereby declaring yourself as a sovereign. I went over earlier in this video what an American actually really is. It was those that was actually found here or discovered here by Europeans once they arrived. We are the true Americans in Al Morocco, a Mexican. Like it, understand it, believe it or not. So the correct term, brothers and sisters, that one should use is actually domicile, not resident. Domicile means you belong here. And we Moors are definitely domiciled in a Mexican, Al Morocco, Islam. So if you are a Moor, you are indigenous to this land and you belong here. You are domicile. If you are Negro, Black, or colored, African-American, Afro-American, Jamaican, Trinidadian, Puerto Rican, you are property of Europeans. And this is the truth, brothers and sisters. So if you use an address, which is actually a fictitious number associated with a designation issued by a corporate ward, then you are under the jurisdiction of those who actually corporate these wards, who are also slaveholders. If you are a citizen of the state of New York, then their ordinances, their codes, their statutes, their regulations apply to you. If you are a citizen of the United States, which is a non-profit corporation, then their codes, their statutes, their ordinances, their regulations, and so on and so forth apply to you. But if you are a Moor, you are in your sovereign capacity and you're in your proper status, carrying your true name, not a European name, such as Mr. Brown, Mr. Black, and so on and so forth, and you are actually in proper persona, you are not a slave. You are a sovereign. If you have not claimed your nationality, you're not separate. Who are you? What is your nationality, brothers and sisters? So, all their applications, all their forms, all their contracts actually places you under their jurisdiction. And brothers and sisters, you have a right to contract. You are now a minor because you're not in proper persona. If you go to court and the judge asks you, are you pro se? Now, pro se has nothing to do with being in appropriate persona. Now, many of you think that it does, but it doesn't. And I'm going to get to that in a moment. So, when you go into the court, brothers and sisters, there's three issues of law that should be dealt with. It should be status, jurisdiction, and adjudication. But when you go to court, they skip status and jurisdiction and they start adjudicating you. They start adjudicating you from the start. And many of you don't know the difference. What do you mean, Tazadaq? Well, they ask you who you are and you declare yourself as the all capital fiction on the paper. And then they say you're being charged with such and such and such and this. How do you plead? That's adjudication. They're adjudicating you. They skip status. They skip jurisdiction. Now, and brothers and sisters, to those of you that go into these courtrooms and tell the judge, well, I have my constitutional rights, he's probably going to throw you behind in the box and find you in contempt of court because the Constitution does not apply in these statutory courts. You cannot go in one jurisdiction talking about something that actually applies in another jurisdiction. Do you follow me? So the Constitution is a contract between the United States Republic and the United States of America. And there are certain clauses in that contract that applies to Moors and the Treaty of Peace of 1787. If you're not familiar, brothers and sisters, with the Treaty of Peace of 1787, you had better get familiar with it ASAP. It is essential that you know this. It's essential. Now, Article 6. If you are a Moor, brothers and sisters, the contract does not apply to you except for the part that discusses the treaty, which is Article 6. If you claim you are a Moor, it is not relevant to go into a public court to discuss anything about that contract known as the Constitution besides the treaty with the United States of America. If you are in propria persona, you do not discuss anything with anyone else besides the judge. The prosecutor is non-existent to you. The prosecutor is invisible to you. Do you follow me? And the judge, since the judge is not an American, and since we're dealing with a foreigner, because you have your nation, which is this Moorish Empire, and they have their nation, and you are the true American, how do you address the magistrate or the judge? My Honor, what is your name? What is your nationality? Under what capacity are you acting? Who issued you the authority to practice law in my land? I'm indigenous to this land. Who issued you the capacity to practice law in my land? Brothers and sisters, this is only if you are in your proper status and you know you have declared your nationality and you are a Moor. Do you follow me? Now, I'm going to get to being in propria persona versus pro se. And then I'm going to close this thing out. But first, I want to go over the basis of an affidavit. Because many of us like to file all other types of documents and don't file affidavits. But we should keep it on affidavits, brothers and sisters. Now, before the corporation took control of this nation, almost all laws, actions were actually initiated by affidavits. Islam, family, brothers and sisters, once again, it's the voice of your brother, Tazadaq, coming at you through the spirit of righteousness and truth, through the spirit of the Most High in Christ, through the spirit of Yahweh Bahasham Yahweh Shah, through the spirit of our forefathers. Since many of us are actually confusing pro se with impropria persona, I decided to actually speak about that particular topic. Many of you actually go in propria persona, but you end up pro se because you really do not understand law as you pretend or think you do. So what is your status? Are you in propria persona? And if so, be the best layman that you can be. Now, many of you go in, you may be in propria persona, but you allow them to get you to consent to being in pro se. And you pretend to know the difference, but you really don't. This is not to insult anyone, but it's just to teach you the truth. And the truth may make you mad again, but it will make you free. And I hope your desire is to be totally free. Now, to be in propria persona, according to Black Law's Fifth, is in his own person. It is a rule in pleading that pleas to the jurisdiction of the court must be pleaded in propria persona. Because if pleaded by attorney, they admit to the jurisdiction. So, as an attorney is an officer of the court, and he is presumed to plead after having obtained leave, which admits to the jurisdiction. So, we must be in propria persona. So, I would like to point out that propria persona is not pro se. Do not allow these courts and judges to deceive you. Take it from me personally. They will attempt to ask you, or you in pro se, or they will ask you, or you pro se. And I will explain the difference shortly. Now, when challenging the personal jurisdiction of these courts in which complaints are filed, family, we must take care that we do not commit an act or admit to an act in such a manner as to give the court personam jurisdiction, a personal jurisdiction over us. Now, ignorance of not knowing the law has plagued us far too long. It's time to study and know law. If we ask the court to do something or allow the court to do something that it can only do under the hypothesis that it has jurisdiction of we, the people, meaning the natural people, before the jurisdiction will be deemed admitted. Now, any further argument against the jurisdiction would be actually be frivolous, irrelevant, and competent under these particular circumstances, and the court would actually proceed accordingly. Do you follow me? So, knowing thus, brothers and sisters, we must appear specially, not generally. We must appear specially challenging the jurisdiction of the court. We appear in our own natural person, in propria persona. According to Black Law's 5th edition, it defines inappropriate persona. It reveals the necessities to appear in the fashion of special appearance. Inappropriate persona in one's own person. It was formerly a rule in pleading that pleas to jurisdiction of the court must be pled in propria persona, because if pled by an attorney, they admit to the jurisdiction. As an attorney is an officer of the court, and he slash she is presumed to plead after obtaining leave, which admits jurisdiction. That's according to Black Law's 5th. And you also can find that Encyclopedia of Law, 2nd edition, 1922, title plea. So a plea, according to Encyclopedia of Law, 2nd edition, 1922, a plea to the jurisdiction asserts the court before which the cause is brought is not the proper court to take cognizance of the matter. Now, brothers and sisters, many of you, you know, you declare yourself as free men, or you might be a member of the free men movement, and you declare yourself as being all wise. Well, many of you said to be freemen, many of you Moors, or many of you litigants has actually appeared pro se rather than in propria persona. Both Black Law's Dictionary 5th edition and Encyclopedia of Law 2nd edition defines pro se as for himself in his own behalf in person. Now, did you notice that the definition does not read in his own person? It did not read in his own person, but it reads for himself. Now, the fact of the matter that it reads for himself is actually given the connotation that while we act for ourselves, we are a separate person, actually defending ourselves as a defendant. Do not allow this. Do you follow me? You must object. You do not ever want to be the defendant. You do not ever want to be the defendant. This would actually require the same leave of the court that the use of an attorney does. Do you follow me? Actually admitting jurisdiction of the court. Now, brothers and sisters, why do we allow these courts, as well as these states, to continuously refer to us as pro se litigants, even after we go in and make it clear to them that we appear specially, not generally, as paramount security holder? I'm making a special appearance. I'm here as intervener. We're appearing in propria persona, but somehow you end up allowing them to actually deceive you into going in as a pro se litigant. We must object. We must object. We must object. If we do not object by our own admissions, we actually admit the jurisdiction. Pro se litigants are actually subjects. And by being a pro se litigant, we are all subjects. And we all subject ourselves to the same rules as esquires, attorneys, lawyers, and so on and so forth. You understand what I'm saying? So you consider to be in the status of one of these lawyers. So lawyers are required to follow a certain procedure, and you're actually placed in a situation that you're actually required to follow that same procedure as lawyers, and you fit into the same status as a lawyer would. Now, since the court considers us as lawyers, and we're actually acting on the behalf of ourselves, or in the behalf of our own proper persons. Now, your court rules may be the same. And this is a rule that I learned when, you know, assisting someone in Texas. So, when I looked at the rules, the term counsel, and this is according to Texas rules, I think it was 59, the term counsel, lawyer, and attorney of record, as used in these rules, shall, in the event of a party appearing pro se, i.e. without counsel, apply to the individual litigants in the same fashion as if they were members of the bar of the state of Texas. And I quote, now that is for those of you that live in Texas, and I advise you to check the rules of your state. So knowing thus, brothers and sisters, as a pro se litigant in the Texas court, the party is actually considered to be a member of the bar, actually requiring leave of the court to prosecute the case, which would actually admit the jurisdiction of the court and cause him to be treated as a franchise officer of the court. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? Do you follow me? So, brothers and sisters, many of you Moors, many of you said to be free men, have appeared in propria persona and argue the rights of counsel of choice, actually demanding the court to actually allow you to use whatever counsel that you prefer. Whether it's a member of the bar or not a member of the bar, or some of you actually request another so-called sovereign citizen to be a master of the court to represent you. Now, this sort of foolishness, brothers and sisters, and that's exactly what it is, is totally inconsistent with appearing specially, or making a special appearance in propria persona. In fact, brothers and sisters, it is actually a complete contradiction to the nature of actually the party's appearance, and displays that you are totally incompetent, or not as competent as you assume that you were about this matter. So if you're appearing in your own proper person, how could you at the same time demand to be represented by counsel without actually retreating from your original position? How could you do it? Study, study, study. Study, brothers and sisters. You got to study. And then when you're done, study yourself. You heard it before. You can't do this without studying. So while we do not waive our rights to counsel, we also make it clear that we are not using counsel in special appearance. We don't use counsel in special appearance, brothers and sisters. That's a contradiction. And the truth needs no apology. Thus, if this lesson cuts you, and it was a cold cut, then perhaps you should eat it, and you might find it insightful. Moors, Jakes, people, we have to be prepared to stand on our own square alone before these courts, with our Creator as our witness. And as our counsel, all your counsel should come from the Heavenly Father and no other. All of our counsel should come from the Most High. Book of Jeremiah 17 verse 5 says, thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man. You putting your trust in this esquire? You putting your trust in this attorney? You putting your trust in this lawyer? He's an officer of the court. It's a brotherhood, brothers and sisters. They don't have a license to practice law anywhere. They have a certificate. They don't have a license to practice law. There is no license to practice law. So the scripture says in Jeremiah 17, verse 5, thus saith the Lord. Who said that? The Father said that. Cursed be the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm. You leaning on another man's arm for support? You expecting this man that works for the system to save you? and whose heart departed from the Lord. And when you do that, your heart has departed from the Lord. Because you're not, you don't study, so you can't present yourselves. So you go to another man, you lean in on this man for support. Well, it don't matter if you get Mr. Smith or Mr. Brown. If you get the devil or Satan, you're still going to catch hell. So the scriptures are clear. You are not to put your trust in any man. Don't put your trust in Tazadaq. I'm just a dispatcher of information. I just facilitate. The lessons are instructed by Yahweh Bahasham Yahweh Shah. The lessons are instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not me. Not Baran. See, you don't lean on another man for support. Yahweh. Yahweh is your support. Yahweh is your support. The Most High is your support. But if you trust in the Most High, brothers and sisters, then you are right and exact. Jeremiah 17, verse 7. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is. Now you're right and exact. And don't go blaming another man for your wrongs. The devil is in you. You better learn to master and control the Satan of self before you go blaming anyone for your shortcomings. Your lower self. Control that Satan of self. Don't depend on another man to handle case before the court. We are only trading one master for another. We must know the issue and procedures of law. So brothers and sisters, when you make a special appearance, you must appear and proper your persona and not having someone represent you, or as they like to say, represent you. When your case has never been presented in the first place. This is why status is important. What is your status? What is your nationality? Okay, you file your freedom papers. You file your documents to be free. Okay, you file this, you file your UCC-1, so on and so forth. Watch this. And I'm going to show you how many of you, you just go and file documents, but you don't really have a clear understanding of what's going on. You file this and you file that, but you still got a name like James Brown or Michael Blackman, Jonathan Sneed. Still slave. I mean, you have a little more power than you thought, but what's your nationality? What's your nationality? Negro, black, and colored? Well, you're still property. You still decline yourself as Negro, black, and colored. You're chattel property. You're fiction. Brothers and sisters, nationalizing the enslaved Moorish Americans in Amoraco is essential. We're trying to teach the importance of actually exercising this. Islam, I serve Lord and Master. Now the first step, brothers and sisters, is to choose a free national name. You can't carry a slave name. If this offends you, then so be it. You can't carry a slave name and be free. You can't carry European names and be free. You have to have a free national name to correct your slave contracted name. Do you understand? Now, to those of you that's actually went into these so-called institutions of higher learning, this is going to be much more complicated for you to understand and for you to get out of. And many of you, if you got a job that's okay, you're not going to want to get out of this. But in the end, you're going to get caught up without your nation. So brothers and sisters, the first step is to get rid of that slave name. Malcolm tried to teach you this. Elijah Muhammad tried to teach you this. So many leaders came and tried to teach you this. You cannot carry the name of another people and consider yourself to be free because you're property of. You think a name has nothing to do with who you are. Well, that name has everything to do with your status. And until you wake up and realize this, you're still a slave. Now, you may then request nationality documents once your name is changed. Or you can just, if you know how to construct them and put them on public record, then you do so. Do you follow me? So these documents include a declaration of name correction, affidavit of name correction, and a judicial notice. Do you follow me? You gotta know your nationality. You got to be in your proper status. Nationality, Tazadaq, what are you talking about? I'm a Negro. I'm black. I'm colored. I'm African American. I don't want to hear this stuff that you're talking. I'm African. Shut up. What is nationality, brothers and sisters? According to Black Law's fourth edition, nationality is that quality or character which arises from the fact of a person's belonging to a nation or state. I've always taught that your nation, your state, is your true country. And I stand on that. So nationality determines the political status of an individual. If you do not know your nationality, you are a minor. Now, many of you get naturalization. Naturalization is not nationality. Many people come here and they get nationalized, or naturalized, should I say, and you become citizens. So now you're subject to the jurisdiction of the United States. You was freer before you done that for educational purpose. The difference between nationalizing yourself is that you are claiming the nation that you belong to. And naturalization means that you are adopting, and once you get naturalized, not nationalized. Nationalize is what you want to do. But to those of you so-called blacks that come here, let's say, for instance, you came from Honduras and you got naturalized. Naturalized means that you are adopting a foreign allegiance and receiving the privileges of citizenship under the allegiance. So if you are a citizen of the United States, then their rules, their codes, their status, their ordinances, and so on and so forth apply to you. You're under their jurisdiction and you're still a slave. So when you nationalize, you claim what already belongs to you. Hey, listen, I'm not Negro, black, or colored. I'm not African American. I'm not Jamaican, so on and so forth. I belong to the Moorish Empire and I'm claiming my nationality. You're claiming what already belongs to you, what the wicked deceivers don't want you to know. So once you nationalize, you're claiming what actually belongs to you. But when you naturalize, you claim what belongs to another and are given the privilege under its rules. Do you follow me? So you're claiming something that belongs to another. You're not a United States citizen. We were never United States citizens. The United States is a federal corporation. The United States is a federal corporation. 28 U.S.C. 3002 subsection 15A. It's a federal corporation. Who are you? What is your status? Who has the ability to nationalize? Well, brothers and sisters, According to the Declarations of Child's Rights of 1959, and I encourage you to get a copy and read it, Principle 3 of these documents states that the child shall be entitled from his birth to a name and a nationality. And according to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights of 1948, and Article 15 states that everyone has the right to nationality, no one shall be arbitrarily deprived of his nationality, nor denied the right to change his nationality. So, brothers and sisters, to answer the question, any child has the ability, and I don't like to use that word child because a child is a fiction, but that's the terminology that they're using. So I would say in a son, a daughter has the ability to nationalize. Why is nationality important? Why is it important to nationalize? It is important to nationalize, brothers and sisters. Why? To claim who you are. To separate yourself from the servitude and the three-fifth clause, the three-fifth man, to separate yourself from the 14th Amendment citizens. You have actually received under these labels, such as Negro, Black, Colored, African-American, Afro-American, so on and so forth. Do you follow me? So, brothers and sisters, you got to nationalize. You got to nationalize and not naturalize. And with that, brothers and sisters, I trust that you've actually gained something from this lecture, and I'm going to bring this to an end. And this is the truth, and if it cuts many, then so be it. But it's the truth, and the truth may make you mad, but it will definitely make you free. And we all should have the desire to be free men and free women. Once again, brothers and sisters, my name is Brother Tazadaq, and I say shalom, Islam, family.